As a particular extra to our weather special, Stormwatch 9 Tracking Severe Storms, we get a chance now to talk to a former warning coordination meteorologist from Gray, Maine, and now the National Lightning Safety Specialist, John Jensenius. And if that name doesn't sound familiar to you, we're going to talk about a few particular events that he saw firsthand. He is the person that over the last 20 years or so, if there was a tornado in New Hampshire or a possible tornado, he went to that spot and inspected the damage for it. So, John, first of all, thank you very much for joining us. It's a great opportunity to talk to you about several different types of events that we get here in New Hampshire. And then, of course, about something that is very difficult to predict, like where lightning is going to strike. So, first of all, let's talk about the 2008 tornado. For you, that was a 2.5-day storm survey. From a storm that went 50 miles, longest track tornado now in New England history, through about a dozen towns here in New Hampshire in 90 minutes. What was the most memorable thing for you in those 2.5 days looking at the damage?
Well, I think probably the most memorable thing was just the amount of damage and the length of the storm itself. When I was out there trying to survey damage, I was trying to document everything that happened in the storm, and just starting in southern areas and working our way northward. And of course, the biggest thing in that particular storm, we did have one fatality, unfortunately, but many areas with lots and lots of trees down, and the incredible amount of damage those trees did to homes throughout the state.
It was an odd storm because we weren't expecting thunderstorms that day. There were flood watches up for southwestern parts of New Hampshire that day. Not much lightning, the report of a funnel cloud in Atkinson, and then it was just a rain-wrapped storm at that point. You may remember this. At the 5-year anniversary, you and I went to a spot just off Route 16 in Ossipee where you said it was probably the height of the damage and probably the height of that storm. And it was a house that was in the woods and was no longer in the woods. What do you remember about that?
Well, a couple things about that. First of all, the path width was just incredible there. And just the trees were just knocked down completely throughout that entire path in that area. But the other thing was the house. And the house, although it had a few broken windows, didn't sustain much damage. And that really shows you that if a house is constructed properly, it can withstand quite a bit of wind. And of course, when we see things like hurricanes, there are certain standards for homes in areas with hurricanes. And really, that example showed you how building a house properly and constructing it so that it can withstand wind would make it less vulnerable to things like a tornado or a hurricane.
It was a very oddball storm, to say the least. So let's get into your wheelhouse here a little bit. You are the National Lightning Safety Specialist for the country, and so you are the one keeping track of all of the numbers. We have been fairly fortunate, all things considered, here in New Hampshire. I believe the statistic is 8 lightning fatalities here in New Hampshire since 1960. That's a really amazing low number for us, considering how many thunderstorms we can have during the summer. One such incident back in June of 2013 at Camp Bell in Gilmanton, there were 23 Boy Scouts injured when they had taken shelter during a lightning strike as a storm was advancing in. You happened to visit that site. What do you remember from that?
Okay, well, first of all, Kevin, you mentioned that New Hampshire has been very fortunate. That is true, and I would almost say New Hampshire has been very, very lucky in that the last fatality was in 1994, 27 years ago. But nationally, when we look at lightning fatalities and what people were involved in, those are all activities that are very common in New Hampshire, things like fishing and boating, hiking, camping, riding, motorcycles, bikes, ATVs. So, all things considered, I have to say New Hampshire has been very, very lucky. Now, as far as the Gilmanton incident, things that I remember, the vulnerability, and this is something that's always concerned me, is that when you have groups of people outside, there are opportunities, if lightning strikes nearby, that large numbers of people can be killed or injured. And this was a case where we saw, as you said, 20-some injuries in the scouts. And I think one of the leaders was also injured in the incident as well. So in that particular case, they were sitting around a table, I think on metal chairs. Lightning struck a tree, I think about 30 feet away, and traveled along the ground. And in so doing, it probably went up through the legs of the chairs and through the campers. Very dangerous situation, because if you're talking about being under a tarp, some people think if they're going to be dry, they're going to be safe, and that's really not true. Lightning follows an electrical path, not the way a raindrop would follow. So I think the thing that struck me most about that is, again, I think we were lucky in that we didn't see any fatalities, but it was the type of incident that concerns me most, where you have a large number of people, they are outside, and being outside makes you vulnerable to a lightning strike.
Certainly, even though it was 8 years ago, a cautionary tale going forward here, considering it has been since the 90s, since we've had a fatality. Let's go through some of the lightning, you know, facts and myths. We always hear lightning never strikes the same place twice. What do you think?
Lightning strikes where it wants to, and it typically strikes the tallest object. So just as an example, the Empire State Building has been struck many times every year. And so lightning striking one place probably indicates it's a little more vulnerable to being struck a second time, just because it struck there once because of perhaps the height. But really, lightning comes down from the clouds as something called a step leader. It doesn't really seek out any particular object, but as it comes down toward the ground, it usually strikes the closest object, whatever that is. And oftentimes, that's the tallest object in the immediate area.
But I guess even to make a finer point on it, it isn't only the tallest object that it's going to hit, correct?
That's correct. It doesn't have to be the tallest object. It doesn't have to be the biggest object. In fact, last year there was a lightning strike not too far from my house in the middle of the woods, and it was one of the smaller trees that was struck and actually literally blown apart. Now, I don't know that it wasn't as tall as the other trees, but if you were in that forest and you were looking at the trees, you would have guessed that it would have struck one of the taller trees. So it really is impossible to know where it's going to strike, which is why it's important to make sure you're in a safe place.
Rubber tires keeping you safe in a car from a lightning storm. True or false?
False. Rubber tires do nothing to protect you from the lightning. It actually is the outer metal shell of a vehicle that protects you from the lightning, and it has to be metal. If lightning strikes the vehicle, it will follow the metal shell around you, and oftentimes exiting either across or through the tires. Many tires now, I think virtually all tires contain metal, and many tires are blown out in a lightning strike.
If you are outside during a lightning storm, lie flat on the ground.
Okay, another one that's false. You definitely don't want to lie flat on the ground. When lightning strikes an object, it then spreads out along the ground. And if you're lying on the ground, that makes you more vulnerable to that lightning strike.
You are in an area and someone is struck by lightning. You go over to that person. Can you also be electrocuted?
No, you cannot. It's important to know that, because if somebody is struck, you want to check them, see that they have a pulse, and if they don't have a pulse, you want to begin CPR right away, and of course call 911.
Lightning starts from the ground or from the sky?
Oh, that's always a very good question, and the answer is sometimes it can strike either way. In your most typical lightning strike, it starts as a what's called a step leader that comes down from the cloud. Once it reaches the ground, the return strike goes up from the ground to the cloud. So the visible flash that you see actually goes upward, although it happens so fast you really can't tell that.
Was just seeing a news story recently of, I believe it was a teacher who was doing remote learning in her house, and she had a laptop on, and the lightning strike hit the house and went through her laptop. She was surprised that it went through her laptop. What would you say to that?
Well, in that case, the laptop almost certainly was plugged into a wall outlet. And anything that's plugged into a wall outlet is dangerous during a thunderstorm, because if lightning strikes your house or the electrical wires very near your house, it can follow those wires into your home and can get to anything that's plugged into the wall. So in that particular case, chances are very good that the laptop was plugged into the wall and it followed the wiring right to the laptop and to the woman.
So to sum up, lightning looks for something tall, something made of metal, water, or the tallest thing in an open space. So the bottom line is you want to seek shelter when that's going on. There isn't any one particular safe place to be outside. Am I right?
There is no safe place outside. So you definitely have to get into a substantial building or a hard-topped vehicle. That is a mistake that many people make. They think that lightning isn't going to strike. I will say, New Hampshire is a wonderful place to be outside during the summertime. And if you're going to be outside, you need to plan on a place that you can get to in case there is a thunderstorm.
I will tell you this, that our app on our phones, our storm tracker app, if you go to the radar in the bottom right, there's a layer portion down there where you can click on that and actually activate the lightning so that during a thunderstorm and when it's moving in, it will give you very recent lightning strikes. So you can tell if a storm moving in is highly electrical versus not as highly electrical. And I think that's an important aspect of this that will probably have people take a look at here as we go forward through the summer months, because while we predict a lot of things in weather, exactly where lightning is going to strike is really not one of those things, and it is not something that's going to be, you know, easily forecasted going forward and exactly where it's going to be. So it's really up to the individual or the group to make sure that they stay safe in that situation. John, National Lightning Safety Specialist, we really appreciate you joining us. I hope you are enjoying retirement otherwise. And again, thank you very much for taking your time to tell us a lot about lightning, because it is one of the many threats that we have during the summer season. And any sort of thunderstorm can give off lightning, and it can be very, very dangerous. John, thank you again.
Thank you, Kevin.